Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Family Abolition, Capitalism and the Communizing of Care by M.E. O'Brien, narrated by Charli Burrow. Introduction. The Oaxaca Commune. In June 2006, 3,000 police officers attacked a teachers' protest in the Mexican city of Oaxaca. The teachers had been on strike for a month, occupying the central square of the city. The police and teachers battled for hours over the course of the day, leading to over 100 hospitalizations. In the aftermath of the confrontation, hundreds of social movement organizations gathered to form the Asamblea Popular de los Pueblos de Oaxaca, APPO, an organization that became the central coordinating body of hundreds of protests and occupations over the coming 7 months. In August, insurgent women seized control of multiple radio stations, going on to use them as communication hubs for the movement. At the end of one radio broadcast of an occupied station, the newscaster concluded, "Transmitting from the Oaxaca Commune." Insurgents took up the name, referencing the Paris Commune of 1871. The militants of the Oaxaca Commune erected hundreds of barricades throughout the city. They used the barricades to defend their neighborhoods against nightly attacks by police and paramilitaries. Many workers were on strike, living full time at the barricades. Many not on strike spent their nights on the barricades after their day's work was done. Insurgents communicated with each other from one barricade to the next, using radio, and began to identify themselves by the name of their barricade. Those barricades became sites of what I call insurgent social reproduction, the transformation of the daily tasks of house labor into means of sustaining militant protest. Baruca Payar writes, "The barricades were places where the people of Oaxaca slept, cooked, and shared food, had sex, shared news, and came together at the end of the day. Women on the barricades redistributed seized goods, conducted educational workshops, gathered supplies, socialized together, and shared life." Payar goes on, "People belonged to the commune simply because they took part in this reproduction of daily life, from cooking at the barricades, carrying coffee to the barricades from homes or businesses, carrying news between barricades, to making Molotovs at barricades, stacking rocks, or simply sharing stories." The women of the Oaxaca commune were engaged in a moment of family abolition. They were rebelling simultaneously against both abusive husbands and racist, anti-indigenous, and anti-worker state forces. They were challenging the social role to which they were relegated as women, as wives, as mothers, upending norms of gender and sexuality. Their collective labor made the rebellion possible. Rather than atomized isolation of private households, during the rebellion, people lived collectively on the barricades. What had made women's work in the home became the daily practice of reproducing the insurrection. Through the barricades, the women of the Oaxaca commune created a new, collective life that overcame the divisions between private and public. They were refusing the private household as a link in the circuits of racial capitalism. For these women, rejection of the family was not a move toward isolation or abandoning caretaking relationships. They brought their children with them to the barricades. They were not simply rejecting maternal caretaking, but radically transforming it. They were expanding the care labor of their private homes into a mass insurrectionary movement for the transformation of society as a whole. In creating the collective life of the barricades, they were constituting a new basis for shared social reproduction and shared intimacy. They were transforming the isolation of domestic life into a means of communal, revolutionary survival. The daily life of the barricades and the city's other occupations became a site of escalating gendered struggle. Many husbands, frustrated their wives at the barricades were no longer serving them in their home, forced their wives to abandon the occupation. A participant recounts, "There were comrades who complained that since August 1st, my woman doesn't serve me. There were many women who suffered domestic violence for being at the occupations and marches. Sometimes their husbands even attempted to divorce or separate. The husbands didn't take well to the idea of women abandoning the housework to participate politically. They didn't help in the sense of doing housework, such as taking care of kids or washing clothes, so that the women could continue being at the station. The reassertion of the family as a system of private, male-dominated households contributed to the defeat of the Oaxaca commune. The women could not act as both frontline militants and obedient wives. The family was a tool of counterinsurgency. The women of the Oaxaca commune rebelled against a system of private households, male-dominated kinship arrangements, and a gendered division of labor. All these are dimensions of the family form that characterize most people's lives under racial capitalism. Families typically exist as private households in segmented isolation from each other, divided by architecture, resources, public policy, and custom. Each family works separately, helping to reproduce capitalist society from one generation to the next. Families raise children and offer them their first socialization in heteronormative gender norms and labor market discipline. Through maintaining a stable family, individuals gain legitimacy, social acceptance, and respectability. People's kinship arrangements and households are judged by the extent to which they manage to obtain an ideal of the family rooted in a long history of white supremacy and capitalism. Through the Oaxaca commune, women sought to overcome the family form. Their efforts in turn made the scale of the mobilization possible. Many popular rebellions share this quality. When large numbers of working-class people move into open rebellion, the boundaries of the family begin to break down. The private household gives way to the collective life of shared, insurgent social reproduction. Those subjugated within the private family seize the opportunities of new ways of living and loving together. Rather than rigid gender roles, people may begin to care for each other as comrades. Replacing private family kitchens or takeout from local restaurants, people may gather around protest kitchens, canteens, and group meals. Care for children, the injured, and others unable to work becomes a shared concern of collective projects of survival. Family abolition is a horizon of human freedom, one briefly visible on the barricades of the Oaxaca commune. Family as limit. The family is a limit to human emancipation. The family's horrors are vast, its abuses widespread, its logic coercive. The family is a joy for some, a necessity for most, and a nightmare for too many. Behind its closed doors, the household is a gamble. Children born into abusive households have no recourse from harmful parents. Those trapped in abusive couple relationships may see their means of escape gradually cut off by manipulative and controlling partners. Those working-class adults who wish to be part of a child's life are forced into degrees of economic precarity to keep their child fed and cared for, trapping parents further within awful jobs. The family policing system targets poor, Black, Indigenous, and migrant families with new forms of state violence in the name of protecting children, leaving the violence of the white, propertied family form untouched. The family is also a limit to our imagination. Many of us grow up in private households and struggle to envision anything else. We can barely conceive of real alternatives to the family. Shared households are often a necessary survival strategy for proletarians, yet most working-class families come under frequent pressure from changing labor market conditions, state policies, or state violence. These pressures make it hard to form and hold together families, but even harder to maintain chosen, non-normative living arrangements. Many imagine and pursue a household that is entirely chosen and a radical alternative to the normative family. But attempts at holding such arrangements together often fall apart over decades of the stress of trying to find and maintain work, to pay rent, to deal with medical emergencies, or to face aging. Others flee shared households altogether, often to find isolation and loneliness. Beyond some variation on the private household, what could possibly provide the care that we all so desperately need? The family is also a limit for many mass social movements and revolutionary struggles. Social revolutions that left untouched the tyranny of the home prevented a deeper social and cultural change that could extend into everyone's lives. So long as the private household is maintained, no revolutionary process can overcome class society. Many reform protest movements run into major internal crisis when they are forced to grapple with conflicts and contradictions often relegated to the family. Countless organizations and parties have been destroyed because they were unable to adequately address sexual assault, intimate partner violence, the unequal gender division of labor, or the demands of child rearing. The family is a limit, and the real movement for collective liberation must abolish it. Family abolition. Family abolition is a fraught phrase. Right-wing critics accuse proponents of family abolition of trying to destroy gender, market relations, and civilization. Progressive opponents of the idea suggest it is an ultra-left fantasy, likely to alienate people, foreclosing the mass constituency necessary for social democratic demands. Some astute skeptics of family abolition point to how Black, Indigenous, and people of color, BIPOC, rely on family relations to survive the racist onslaught of the state. Many imagine that family abolition calls for the acceleration of the current neoliberal social forces that make having children or finding a stable home challenging for so many people. These critiques of family abolition reflect deep anxieties. Many people rely on their family when they are at their most vulnerable, as newborns and children, while sick or disabled, while aging and approaching death. For those lucky enough to have loving family members, such support can be a source of great solace. Even those with unsupportive families of origin may keep them close throughout their lives. Those who raise us have a profound impact on our emotional, physical, and social development. Parenting, in turn, can be an extraordinary space of self-growth and experience of long-term care for another person. Unlike most relationships in a capitalist society, families can offer what feels to be an unconditional and unwavering form of love, at least sometimes. It is through the language of family that people often articulate their yearnings for care, for affection, for the long-term interweaving of our lives. For those with cruel or harmful families, the idea of doing it better, of forming healing chosen families, can be profoundly compelling. Family abolition provokes in listeners fears of being abandoned, of being without support, of being left alone to face the violent power of the state or the cruelty of work. These are nearly universal fears in an era of neoliberal dismantling of social welfare supports, increasing atomization of capitalist society, racist state violence, and generalized instability. Many imagine family abolition as the left robbing them of their only means of solace and survival. In their imagination, to abolish the family is to make the world unlivable. Human life depends on care. We are inescapably interdependent. In our society, many important forms of care are often concentrated in families. Everyone needs material supports. For some, these are found through a family's access to jobs or property, safe housing, financial support during difficult times, healthy food, mobility, or quality health care. But the basis of a rich human life also includes the emotional, interpersonal, and physical support families provide. These are all basic human needs, and the family is where we are most likely to have found them. To those who fear family abolition, abolishing the family sounds as if it involves eliminating access to care. However, the opposite is true. Family abolition is a commitment to making the care necessary for human flourishing freely available throughout society. Rather than relying solely on one's immediate personal relationships, access to care could be built into the social fabric of our collective lives. Family abolition is the vision that the basis of thriving should not depend on who your parents happen to be, who you love, or who you choose to live with. Family abolition is a horizon of sexual and gender freedom beyond the bigotry imposed by those on whom we depend. Family abolition is the expansion of care as a universal, unconditional social good. Family abolition is not just the positive assertion of care, but also a refusal of the harmful relationships of domination that family form enables. Family abolition is a belief that no child should be trapped by cruel parents, no woman should be afraid of poverty or isolation in leaving her violent husband. No aging, disabled, or sick person should be afraid of having to depend on an indifferent and uncaring family member. Family abolition is the recognition that no human being should ever own or entirely dominate another person, even children. No individual should have the means to coerce intimacy or labor from another, as current property relations enable. Family abolition is the destruction of private households as systems of accumulating power and property at the cost of others' well-being. As well as overcoming the private household, family abolition is also the radical overturning in how society values particular family forms at the expense of others. A long history of white supremacy, heteronormativity, and capitalist property relations have enshrined a particular narrow vision of the family as the basis of an orderly society. Certain family norms are upheld in law, enforced through state violence, and defended in popular culture. Family abolition is a call for embracing the many forms of care and love through which people can form rich and fulfilling lives. It is for the destruction and overcoming of an ideal that treats some family structures as normal while devaluing or destroying other care relations. As a meditation on family abolition, this book sets out to offer three linked arguments. First, it details a diagnosis of the ongoing crisis of the family today. Part one of this book engages multiple dimensions of family to understand this crisis, focusing on the family as private household and as a site of violence. Families as private households are embedded in the broader circuits of property, labor markets, and the state. All these link together to reproduce capitalist society as a whole. The family simultaneously is a site of multiple forms of violence. Through the racist, heterosexual normative ideals of family, institutions of racial capitalism assault chosen care relations. In trying to function within racial capitalism, families are pushed to embody a normative ideal set out in public policy and the cultural imagination. Yet this ideal is impossible without the stabilizing foundations of property, whiteness, and empire. Shrouded in privacy and bound by relationships of dependency, families readily enable violence and abuse. Second, this book is a history of family forms in capitalist society and the changing visions of its overcoming. Part 2 offers a history of the family and anti-family struggle embedded in the dynamics of capitalist development. Over the last 200 years, revolutionaries have repeatedly come up against the family form and imagined something more. Family abolition has taken on many meanings in each era of mass struggle. The destruction of bourgeois society and private property, the rebellion against white supremacy, the collectivization of household chores and cooking, the rejection of suburban isolation. All these meanings will be explored throughout this book, along with the particular conditions in capitalist society that gave them each substance. Third, this book concludes with a specific speculative vision for what family abolition could become in our future. Family abolition entails imagining how a revolutionary transformation of society may enable new ways of approaching things we ask of our families today: raising children, forming intimate relationships, cooking and eating, managing disability and illness, and aging and death. This may be accomplished in many ways. In part 3, I offer an imagining of the commune as a social form that arises during the escalation of mass insurgency against capitalism and the state. Like the women of the Oaxaca commune, making daily life communal can be a strategy of insurrection and survival, a means of abolishing the family. Structure of the book. Part 1 lays out the core concepts of the book through examining the crisis of the family in the present. Chapter 1 uses the context of the coronavirus pandemic lockdowns to explore a primary meaning of family as used throughout this text: the family as private household. Private households are embedded in the circuits of the reproduction of capitalist society. However, they are not sufficient on their own to complete the basic tasks of raising children, caring for the elderly, or making it from one day of work to the next. I offer the threefold schema of the family, the market, and the state as the three main means of survival under capitalism, a framework I later used to identify the changing place of the family in capitalist society. Chapter 2 considers a photograph in the aftermath of racial terror to explore the family as a racial, normative, and social ideal. This chapter considers two dimensions of the family as a source of violence: the external violence inflicted by the family policing system and racial capitalism, and the internal violence enabled by the family's particular combination of coercion and care. This internal violence is a mechanism of socializing gender roles, imposing heterosexual norms, and maintaining male domination. Chapter 3 turns to another positive meaning of family: the plea for love, for help, and for salvation. Taking as my point of departure George Floyd's call for his deceased mother, I introduce the movement to go beyond the family as the fulfillment of this plea. In the struggle for human freedom, movements periodically point the way to the possibility of moving beyond the family into less coercive means of interpersonal care. This chapter also grapples with the tensions between abolition as destruction and abolition as transformation, and is written in dialogue with the multiple revolutionary political traditions that raise the call of abolition. Part 2 outlines a history of family abolition, one that follows the changing role of the family in racial capitalism. The nuclear family is a recent historical phenomenon, essentially unique to the capitalist era. Its dominant forms and how accessible it has been have changed over the last two centuries. Chapters 4 through 9 delve into the past, examining the changing meanings of family abolition over the course of capitalist development, explained through the changing role of the working class family. In each phase, proletarian struggle against the family was the horizon of gender and sexual freedom. Yet the particular means and form of this struggle changed over time, as the place of the family in capitalist development changed. Table 1 provides an outline of these historical changes. Table 1. Dominant family form, 1830s to 1880s, bourgeois white property-owning family, 1890s to early 1970s, respectable working-class white male bread-winning family form, made possible by workers' movement, 1970s to present, diversification of family but persistence of private household. Transforming working-class families, 1830s to 1880s, capitalist assault on peasant and working-class kin relations, crisis of working-class reproduction, 1890s to 1950s, war mobilization of World War I and World War II, 1960s to early 1970s, growth of office employment opportunities for women, 1970s to present, working class male breadwinner family form impossible. Family racial politics, 1830s to 1880s, natal alienation and plantation slavery, genocide of settler colonialism, 1890s to 1950s, coerced heterosexuality through Jim Crow sharecropping and land allotments to indigenous families, consolidation of whiteness as respectability, 1960s to early 1970s, racist state welfare policies against black and indigenous motherhood, suburbs as whiteness, 1970s to present, continuing racist state attacks in border enforcement, police violence, and mass incarceration. Family abolition visions, 1830s to 1880s, destruction of bourgeois family in war on bourgeois society, Engels, Fourier, most socialists and anarchists, 1890s to 1950s, collectivizing unwaged reproductive labor, moving working-class women into wage labor and freeing them from compulsory family, Kalantai, 1960s to early 1970s, radical feminists, queers, and black women seek to abolish the suburban, isolated family unit towards sexual and gender liberation. 1970s to present, new wave of family abolition, trans Marxist, queer communist, black feminist, and beyond to the commune. I begin my account of past struggles against the family in Chapter 4, with the family politics of capitalist industrialization in Europe, following the arguments of Marx and Engels. Capitalism destroyed the peasant family, pulling new proletarians into the factories of the great towns. There, low wages, overcrowding, and factory labor prevented proletarians from forming stable family structures. Marx and Engels direct their family abolitionist politics, therefore, against the nuclear family form of the capitalist class. Family abolition is a component of the destruction of the institutions foundational to capitalist society, including bourgeois society, private property, and the state. Chapter 5 turns to the racial capitalism of 19th century North America, considering settler colonialism and plantation slavery. Anti-indigenous genocide and the natal alienation of slavery attacked kin relations. Concurrently, racial capitalism consolidated the white heterosexual family, both among slave-owning oligarchs and frontier homesteaders. Later in the 19th century, the family politics of white supremacy shifted as Jim Crow mandated heterosexual marriage on black sharecroppers and land allotments sought to break up indigenous life into private, patriarchal families. Chapter 6 counterposes the oppressive family politics of 19th century capitalism to glimpses of proletarian sexual transgression. Sex workers, sodomites, and transfeminine proletarians engaged in rebellion and resistance. Emancipated black people forming non-normative family relations during Reconstruction, and the thinking of French utopian socialist Charles Fourier. Chapter 7 traces the rise and consolidation of a particular form of the workers' movement toward the end of the 19th century. A strata of workers won access to a kind of family that resembled those of their bourgeois adversaries. Based on a single male breadwinner, children in school, and an unwaged housewife. Socialists of the Second International grappled with the place of the family in their thinking, torn between the movement's conflicting commitments to gender equality through full proletarianization and to the stability and respectability of the housewife family form. Briefly, the Bolshevik Revolution opened a vision of family abolition through the full collectivization of household labor. Chapter 8 turns to the uprising of the Red Decade, a phrase for the global insurgencies from the mid-1960s to the mid-1970s. The family again came under attack by revolutionaries. Multiple movements contested the suburban, heterosexual, white, housewife-based family form. Here I focus on three specific struggles focused on the United States: black women radicals, including as welfare rights organizers, radical feminism, and gay and trans liberationists. Chapter 9, concluding part 2, returns us to the present. Since the mid-1970s, working-class family life has been increasingly thrown into disarray. This has been a result of a deeper, protracted global crisis in profitability and the displacement of this crisis onto the working class. The housewife form is no longer viable for any sector of the working class. Further, people are increasingly pursuing new modes of living outside of traditional family structures and its normative regime of sex and gender. Queer relationships, gender transitions, living alone, postponing or avoiding marriage, and much else. But these have been concurrent with increased dependency on the private household. Part 3 considers resistance to the family. Chapter 10 argues that the struggle to move beyond the family can link multiple constituencies. Progressive anti-family reforms are policy changes that materially expand people's ability to choose their own household arrangements or undo the regulatory policies that bolster normative families. Chapters 11 through 13 move into family abolition as a horizon of a freer society. In Chapter 11, I begin by outlining other writers' visions of family abolition. Then I theorize the essential qualities of what I call communist social reproduction, based on the maxim, from each according to their ability, to each according to their need. Chapter 12 examines existing protest movements to consider how they practice care and interdependence beyond the market and the state. At protest camps, mass occupations, and other struggles, people form collective practices for social reproduction. Like the Oaxaca commune, these can point toward the potential mechanisms of family abolition. Chapter 13 speculatively sketches the commune as one possible mode through which new forms of social reproduction emerge in the course of mass insurrection and revolutionary struggle. In the conclusion, I use Martin Luther King Jr.'s vision of beloved community alongside Marx's notion of Gemeinwesen to argue that family abolition can be a guiding ethic of interdependence and care. Overall, this book is a work of communist theory that draws from multiple political and theoretical traditions. It depends on prior rigorous research in historical materialism, social reproduction theory, family abolitionism, black feminism, black theology, indigenous studies, socialist and anarchist politics, gay liberationism, queer theory, and writing by trans and queer radicals. At multiple points, I also engage relevant dimensions of a specific and somewhat obscure communist theoretical tradition called communization. In understanding communization theory, I draw from the work of the French collective Théorie Communiste and the Anglophone journal Endnotes. I introduce and outline their work gradually in relevant sections, beginning in Chapter 7. In the spirit of the Oaxaca Commune, let us advance. Part 1. The Impossible Family. 1. Private Households. In March and April 2020, large swaths of the global capitalist economy ground to a halt in the face of the coronavirus pandemic. Over the following years, periodic general quarantine shut down work and travel. During these lockdowns, the working class of advanced capitalist countries faced three possible fates: unemployment, continuing to work on-site at their place of employment, or remote work. Millions lost work in the biggest economic plunge since the 1930s. Emergency cash transfer benefits, eviction moratoriums, and economic bailout packages staved off an even worse social crisis. Those who continued to work outside of their homes, disproportionately black and migrant working class people, faced higher rates of exposure to COVID-19 with lethal consequences. The last third or so of the workforce switched to remote work for the remainder of the year. These were most often white-collar professionals who had previously worked in offices. This new experience of home life revealed the labor, both within and beyond the household, required to sustain families. Every day, there is a great deal of work to be done: acquiring and preparing food, feeding everyone in the household, accessing health care and education, cleaning homes and bodies and clothes, supervising children, and tending to the elderly or disabled. Working-class families of color tend to manage such labor with the help of interdependent kin structures beyond their nuclear family, including through relying on grandparents, aunts, and family friends. They also rely on state-subsidized child care centers and public schools. Affluent parents are those working as busy professionals, more likely to be isolated into a nuclear family household, manage these tasks through outsourcing the labor to others, hiring immigrant nannies and house cleaners, ordering takeout meals, dropping children off at private daycare or schools, using laundry services, or placing grandparents in nursing homes. Outsourcing domestic labor is not new. Bourgeois European families employed servants in large numbers up until World War II, for example, while white propertied American families employed black women as domestic workers from Reconstruction to the 1960s. Before emancipation, enslaved black women provided child care, household labor, and breastfeeding, integrated into the domestic life of white owners. However, today's professional families rely not only on low-wage migrant domestic workers, but also on access to a wide assortment of service commodities such as food preparation, laundry, and on-call drivers. Along with the institutions of universal schooling and separated senior residential facilities, these commodified reproductive services have enabled busy professionals to raise families without necessarily relying on the unwaged support of extended family or a housewife. COVID-19 temporarily shattered these intricate networks of sustaining professional families. With schools closed, parents working from home, and most service industry businesses abruptly shutting down, parents suddenly found their task utterly impossible. The COVID-19 shutdowns made it clear that caring and educating children every day is completely beyond the capabilities of one or two parents simultaneously trying to maintain a waged job. Along with the concentrated mass death in nursing homes and the social isolation of the nuclear family under the quarantine, COVID-19 sparked a crisis of anxiety and doubt among professionals about the nuclear family. The ideological representatives of the property class, figures such as David Brooks, began to openly question the wisdom of the nuclear family structure as a viable unit of daily life. COVID-19 intensified many people's experiences of their family as a private household. Social distancing practices and the closure of public institutions forced everyone back into their household, trapped and alone with their cohabitants. Within family households, the typical emotional and financial interdependency became much more strained and intense. Raising children, financial support of each other, house cleaning, cooking, all these activities had to be done within the isolated family household to an extent not seen in many decades. Those not currently in a family household found themselves alone or with roommates who might be near strangers. Those without households, those living and reproducing themselves as individuals, faced an intense level of isolation and loneliness throughout the pandemic. Living with a family was impossible. Living without one, even worse. As the pandemic shutdowns continued, people cobbled together other strategies for meeting their material needs. Mutual aid support networks emerged across major cities. In New York City, for example, the intensity and speed of the shutdown left many people without easy access to purchasing food. Volunteer bicycle messengers delivered groceries to people who were scared to leave their homes, or to those living in neighborhoods where local grocery stores began to run out of supplies. In thousands of apartment buildings, people went door to door to check on their neighbors. Through these networks, many briefly glimpsed a different vision of care. Mutual aid exceeded the limits of the family, or the inequalities of purchasing services on the market. A flurry of activist books documented this rich moment of mutual aid, recognizing its connection to a long-standing organizing tradition. But this opening was short-lived. Grocery stores reorganized, creating home delivery options and hiring working-class men of color as low-wage delivery workers. Online retailers expanded and filled enough of the gaps in their commodity chains. Once again, people retreated to surviving through means more familiar in capitalist society: their immediate kin, marginal state aid, their jobs, and purchasing food and services. Underfunded public schools slowly readjusted to online learning where they were able. Private day camps, tutoring programs, and schools filled the educational gaps for families who could afford it. Low-income service workers were increasingly called back to work, even with the higher risk and mortality. As vaccines became available in the United States over the spring of 2021, white-collar workers also returned to the office. Echoes of the crisis remained. Throughout 2021, the service economy that fills reproductive needs of households did not return to a pre-pandemic normal. Huge numbers of service industry workers, hit hard by pandemic deaths and having enjoyed the respite from degrading work, refused to return to their previous workplaces. Millions of people quit their jobs, creating an unusually tight labor market in the United States. Service industry employers that depend on a desperate, low-wage workforce found themselves unable to fill their job positions. Through the summer of 2021, Children's Camps, a major child care provider for professional families, struggled to fill staffing shortages. Parents were forced to collect their kids from camp and to find other options for the reproductive labor of child care. These professional families suddenly experienced the advent of what had long plagued parents who were less well off: a care crisis. Working-class families face compounding factors fueling this lasting and worsening care crisis, including falling wages, fragmentation of marital and other family relations, and cutbacks in public services. These material conditions force working-class mothers to work longer hours of both waged and unwaged work. Different sectors of the working class have experienced this crisis in varied ways. It is no longer affordable for nearly anyone to keep a mother out of the workforce, though this was once a feasible possibility for better-off white working-class families. For black and migrant mothers, and others in the lower tiers of the working class, however, the housewife family form has never been obtainable. For them, this care crisis has been compounded by state violence, mass incarceration, and the dismantling of poverty relief services. The effects of the coronavirus pandemic made it starkly evident that working class families have always been asked to do too much work. The tasks of daily and generational social reproduction are more than any family can bear alone. Vast hours of work are needed to care for the elderly, to raise and educate children, to keep everyone fed and clothed and housed, all to enable family members to make it to work the next day. Social reproduction theory argues that this people-making within and beyond the nuclear family plays an essential role in the functioning of capitalism, the creation of a viable workforce each day and across each generation. Everyone needs others beyond our families in order to survive. Families depend on outside help, linking the family into broader networks of care. Nuclear families cannot carry the immense burden of work placed on them. In capitalist society, this extended support typically takes the form of extended family, of services purchased on the market, or through increasingly limited state programs and institutions. Without these supports, families are crushed under the impossible burden of reproductive labor. This necessary dependency of families on outside support reproduces the inequality of market relations, dividing people's material conditions and life chances by class, by race, and by family structure. The care crisis of the coronavirus pandemic illuminated how families function as private households, a key dimension of the family laid out in this chapter. Family as private households. The meaning of the family is fraught. As a link in the cycles of capitalist reproduction, the role of the family has changed repeatedly, and its form usually varies drastically given its members' place in class society. Everyone citing the family as an aspirational ideal brings their own political commitments and values to how the concept is imagined and articulated. Debates about the meaning of family quickly become emotionally charged. For one speaker, family may be a primary source of love and care. Yet for another, it may represent their most intense experience of subjugation and abuse. This book uses the term family in multiple senses, recognizing its myriad uses and meanings in society today. Other scholars and critics of the family have productively emphasized the family as a site of ideological reproduction and socialization, as a rhetorical trope and fantasy wielded to advance various regressive political positions, as an institution producing atomization and isolation, as a system of biogenetic kinship, as a juridical and legal category, as a metaphor of national belonging, and much more. These varied definitions of family make appearances throughout this book. This chapter focuses on one meaning, family as private household, a unit of privatized care. Identifying the family as a private household helps make sense of how families situate us within the circuits of capitalist reproduction. In the next chapter, I shift to other contrasting meanings of family, organized by external and internal violence. These meanings of family are woven throughout this book. A household is made up of people who live together, who share resources together, and who are interdependent on each other in decisions about employment, housing, and schooling. They function partially as a single economic unit. Often, the family as private household also consists of formal, legal, and biological kinship units, constituted by marriage, procreation, and genetic ties. These relationships can be especially charged, often people's primary emotional attachments. Households can include multiple generations of a family, but increasingly under capitalism, they are primarily composed of nuclear families, adults and their minor children. A household may also be chosen family, as close friends, complex kinship ties, or members of a shared community housing together. Chosen family function as households in the sense used here, insofar as they are intimately economically interdependent and systems of organizing private care, such as relying on each other during periods of unemployment. The family as a household manages and coordinates forms of labor within the home. Within the household, the family is the site through which people receive much of the care they need to survive. The family raises children, cares for members when sick or infirm, and provides primary support to members who are disabled or out of work. This care takes many forms, including emotional comfort, romantic love, financial aid, and meeting of immediate bodily needs. In our society, these needs are primarily met through the private domain of the family as household. The private family serves as the primary site in capitalist society of interpersonal care and social reproductive labor. Yet as sites of work, families are unusual. The experience of family life often depends on the illusion of being free of transactions or exchange. Instead of impersonal domination characteristic of market relationships, the power relationships within a family are quite personal forms of intimacy or control. Domineering husbands might command their wives. Parents might command their children. These hierarchies are naturalized and fiercely defended. Unlike most jobs, much of a household's internal labor is often unwaged. House cleaning, cooking, child care, and other reproductive care may, in some contexts, be outsourced to wage workers outside the family. Yet when these tasks are done by family members, they are typically performed without pay by feminized members of the household, often mothers or wives. Despite the illusion of being free of internal exchange, one's power within a family is often linked to access to outside resources. Among family members, it is typically adult men who have the best access to outside wages, accrued property, social privilege, or legal legitimacy. Those often male family members with the most access to outside resources can leverage them to reduce their personal responsibility for household labor and increase their authority within the family. Family as private household also helps identify the uneven accessibility of the family form for proletarians. Many people throughout history have social relations they may call their family, but are not recognized as such by dominant social institutions. Elements of this mismatch are explored in the next chapter. One aspect of this exclusion from a recognized family is not having the means to form and maintain a private household. Relationships between enslaved people, for example, could never constitute an economic unit of the household. Those living in severe poverty often have too much instability in housing arrangements to maintain a private household. Many working-class people across history could not afford to rent a separate living space for their immediate household, instead forced to live with multiple other non-family members. These people may understand themselves as having families, but their immediate relationships do not quite constitute a private household as a unit of privatized care. The household in capitalist reproduction. Capitalism, like other class societies before it, depends on the family as a form of privatized social reproduction. Capitalism relies on a large number of people being able to show up for work each day, and for the workforce to be maintained from one generation to the next. Those people don't just magically appear. They arrive at the workplace, having been raised and cared for by families. For every worker, someone had to gestate and give birth to them, care for them as infants, raise them as children, and teach them the skills to navigate the labor market and find a job. From one day to the next, someone has to wash their clothes, provide them with the means of bathing, and feed them. This is an immense amount of work, dependent on extensive infrastructures of housing, fresh water, waste disposal, and access to basic goods. The reproduction of the workforce requires a whole other form of work that takes place outside of industrial manufacturing, and often outside the wage relation altogether. These are essential points of social reproduction theory. Capitalism also created and enforced a series of important social divisions in how work is organized, largely unknown in feudal societies. These divisions reconstituted the character of the family as a unit of reproduction. Industrial development gradually and increasingly separated the unwaged reproductive labor done in the home from waged labor, which was increasingly done in workplaces located outside the home. New systems of wage labor, private property, and social legitimacy under capitalism separated the privacy of the family house from the public and political sphere. Capitalist development also took up and expanded distinctions between different forms of waged work, such as feminized reproductive labor focused on direct people-making, childcare, and the masculinized labor focused on social control or object-making. In each case, how these divisions were made seemed natural and intractable, but the particular form of these divisions rapidly changed with each era of capitalist development and particular dynamics between class and capital. The role of the family in class society was remade through these divisions introduced by capitalist production. The functions of the family as economic units vary between classes. Capitalist families may pass down accumulated property and wealth through inheritance. Households with wealth are structures of ownership and property relationships. Spouses generally jointly own whatever assets and debt they have acquired. Bonds between children and adults are managed through promised inheritance or monetary aid. Power dynamics within the family unfold through access to wealth and control over financial decision-making. For working-class people, families can be important strategies for sharing limited resources and sustaining each other when work is unavailable. The family serves as the primary institution mediating access to the wage for working-class people. Proletarian families may share their wages and debt. Some privileged strata of the working class may aid their adult children in accessing a particular form of work, or after their death, leave an inheritance of a privately owned home. Each class works to instill in children its particular values and strategies for navigating the world, and to support its children in acquiring the best opportunities available. Class inequality and the class relations of capitalism are reproduced through the family as a system of private households. Recognizing the working class household as a segment of capitalist society raises challenging political questions. Social reproduction theory evolved in part through Marxist feminist debates in the 1970s about the specific role of the housewife and the private household in capitalist reproduction. Working women were challenged by what feminist scholars called the double shift, the additional unwaged housework they had to do after getting home from paid jobs. Many women saw the question of household labor as linked to struggles over sex, parenting, relationship abuse, and their efforts to build fulfilling lives. Socialist feminists argued that these struggles over housework were integral to the broader struggle against capitalism. They sought to link fights by women over housework to campaigns by unions and socialist organizations over waged work and state power. The theoretical side of these debates often narrowly focused on the question of whether unwaged household labor creates value, a specific and technical idea in Marxist theory. Unfortunately, these debates often did not explicitly state the political consequences of their positions. Implicitly, the discussion centered on whether household labor was a legitimate issue of struggle by the working class. Should women's demands specifically about household labor be included in socialist organizing strategy? For working-class families, these struggles challenged the internal relationships between family members, upending gender roles within heterosexual relationships. Some activists called for wages for housework as a way of drawing attention to the vast, unwaged labor often done by working-class women within the household. This campaign was one of several efforts to politicize and mobilize both housewives and working mothers as political agents, challenging the private domain of the family. All these efforts echoed a long-standing debate among socialists. Was the way to winning gender equality through having all women working outside the home for wages? Could the private, unwaged, atomized labor of housework be transformed into a collective, waged social good? Should those doing unwaged housework within the family demand that their work be respected and valued? How did struggle by housewives and working mothers over unwaged household labor relate to the struggles of black and brown paid domestic workers, or incarcerated women, or sex workers? Wages for housework, the household labor debate, and socialist feminists were arguing that the family was one site in the broader reproduction of capitalism. This book relies on their framework. Alongside the family, two other sites are central to social reproduction in capitalist society: the exchange of commodities and paid work on the market, and the activity of state institutions. Analyzing them together is essential for making sense of the changing role of the family under capitalism. The family, the market, and the state. The family, the market, and the state collectively enable the reproduction of capitalist society. Each institution is dependent on the others for its functioning. Though no single institution entirely determines the rest, the market is the primary driver of major historical change. These three institutions interconnect to reproduce all the key aspects of capitalist society, interrelating both on a large scale across history and in the specific minutiae of our day-to-day lives. Food, housing, and physical care are provided by some combination of the unwaged help of family members, buying commodities at a local store, and receiving aid from a government agency. Most workers in most eras of capitalist society return to private households when they get off work. Through the interrelationships of this threefold schema of the family, the market, and the state, Part 2 of this book traces the changing dynamics of the family over time. Part 3 imagines family abolition as the necessary overcoming of these.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.